Three-dimensional coordinate systems, level 5. In the last video, we started introducing common formulas associated with a three-dimensional Cartesian coordinate system, specifically the midpoint and distance formula. We will continue covering the distance formula by going over a couple of examples. Let's try the first example. Find the distance between the points 4, 3, 1 and negative 2, 5, 7. Notice that these are the same points from the midpoint example from the previous video. Let's go ahead and use the same graph that we used from that video. The first point will be located here, and the second point will be located here. This time around, the problem is asking for the distance between these two endpoints. In other words, the length of the line segment connecting these two points. It's just a matter of using the distance formula. A word of caution, the common mistake that many students make is not being consistent with the coordinates of each point. Notice that it's up to you which point you decide to designate as point 1 and which one you designate as point 2. As long as you're consistent, everything will work out. I'm going to designate the point with coordinates 4, 3, 1 as point 1 and designate the point with coordinates negative 2, 5, 7 as point 2. This means that the coordinates 4, 3, and 1 are going to represent x1, y1, and z1 respectively. In the same manner, the coordinates negative 2, 5, and 7 are going to represent x2, y2, and z2 respectively. So I'm going to subtract the x coordinates of the points from each other and square them. I will do the same for the y and z coordinates. Notice that we need to make sure we subtract the correct coordinates from each other. In this case, we need to subtract the x coordinates, y coordinates, and z coordinates from each other. Where you start getting into trouble is when you start switching the coordinates and start subtracting the wrong coordinate pairs. For example, you might end up subtracting an x-coordinate with a y-coordinate, or an x-coordinate with a z-coordinate. The best way to avoid this mistake is by appropriately labeling the coordinates given, so you can keep track which numbers represent the specific coordinates you're looking for. By subtracting the coordinates of the second point with that of the first point, we obtain the following. Then we square each result and obtain the following. Then we go ahead and add them. Lastly, we take the result and take the square root. We can simplify the radical expression by breaking it into a product of a square number and a factor of 76. In this case, 4 times 19. Doing that, and simplifying the expression, we obtain the distance between point 1 and point 2, which ends up being equal to 2 square root 19. Alright, let's try the next example. Determine whether the points P, Q, and R lie on a straight line. In other words, are they collinear? How can we determine if these three points lie in the same straight line? There's actually a couple of ways. Consider the following. Say we have three random points. Let's call them point A, point B, and point C. Let's also assume, for now, that they are collinear, meaning they lie on the same straight line. If this was the case, then it can easily be seen that the distance between point A and point C has to equal to the sum of the distance between AB and BC. From elementary geometry, the sum of the length of the two smaller line segments has to equal to the length of the line segment that includes these two smaller line segments. Alternatively, we can also use the following idea. If three points are not collinear, then they form a triangle. If this is the case, then by using the properties of triangles established in elementary geometry, we can show that the sum of the two sides must be greater than the third side. In other words, if these three points are not collinear, then they form a triangle, and we would have to show that the sum of two line segments has to be greater than the third side of the triangle. In other words, we need to show that line segment AB plus line segment BC is greater than line segment AC, and that line segment BC plus line segment AC is also greater than line segment AB. And finally, line segment AB plus line segment AC is greater than line segment BC. In either case, we need to find the length formed by each point and use one of these geometric relations to verify that they are collinear. Let's use the first geometric relation, since it's a lot easier to work with. Let's first find the length of each line segment. The line segment formed by point P and Q is found by subtracting the coordinates from each point and then squaring them. Doing that, we obtain the following. Then we continue simplifying the expression and obtain the following radical expression. We can further simplify this expression by breaking 18 into a product of a square number and another factor of 18. In this case, 9 times 2. Then we go ahead and simplify the expression, obtaining 3 root 2. Next, we find the length of the line segment QR. Once again, we use the distance formula and substitute the coordinates of each point. Doing that, we obtain the following expression. Then we go ahead and square the terms and simplify. Doing that, we obtain the following. We can simplify the radical expression by breaking it into a product of a square number and a factor of 72. In this case, 36 times 2. Then we go ahead and simplify the expression, obtaining 6 root 2. Finally, we go ahead and find the length of line segment PR. So we use the distance formula and substitute the coordinates of each point. Doing that, we obtain the following expression. Then we go ahead and square the terms and simplify. Doing that, we obtain the following. We can simplify the radical expression by breaking it into the product of a square number and a factor of 162. In this case, 81 times 2. Then we go ahead and simplify the expression, obtaining 9 root 2. Having found the length of each line segment, let's create a diagram to aid us in determining if these points are collinear. We know from the distances we found that points P and R form the endpoints of the longest line segments. This means that point Q has to be between these two points. Now, let's go ahead and determine if the sum of the two smaller line segments add up to the line segment that includes these two smaller line segments. In other words, we're determining if the length of line segment PQ plus the length of line segment QR is equal to the length of line segment PR. Let's go ahead and substitute the values for each line segment. Doing that, we have the following. Next, let's simplify the left side of the equation. Notice how the left side is equal to the right side of the equation, meaning it checks out. Since this relation turned out to be true, we conclude that these points are indeed collinear. They lie in the same straight line. If we decided to use the second geometric relation, specifically proving that the line segments form a triangle, we would have to show that the sum of two line segments has to be greater than the third side of the triangle for all the following cases. The length of the line segment PQ plus QR has to be greater than line segment PR. The length of line segment PR plus PQ has to be greater than line segment QR. And the length of line segment QR plus PR has to be greater than line segment PQ. Let's go ahead and substitute the value of the lengths for each line segment into the relations. Doing that, we obtain the following. Next, we go ahead and simplify the left side of each inequality. Notice that the first inequality is false. The second inequality is true, and the third inequality is true. We're testing to see if these points form a triangle. We need all three inequalities to be true, but since the first inequality is false, we conclude that they do not form a triangle, meaning they must lie in the same straight line. They are indeed collinear. Alright, let's move along and continue exploring equations in three-dimensional space. In the first videos, we introduced the basic equations of coordinate planes. Now we will explore the three-dimensional version of a circle. Recall that the equation of a circle in R squared, with center HK and radius R, is defined to be the set of all points XY, such that the distance between XY and HK is equal to the radius R. The distance between point P and point C has to equal R. Mathematically, we can express this as follows. The distance between the center, C, and a point on the circle, P, is equal to R. The distance between P and C can be found by using the distance formula in two dimensions. So we substitute the distance PC with the following expression. The square root of the quantity x minus h squared plus the quantity y minus k squared equals R. We can make the equation more user-friendly by squaring both sides of the equation. Doing that, we obtain the final equation of a circle with center hk. The quantity x minus h squared plus the quantity y minus k squared equals r squared. Keep in mind that this equation represents a circle in two-dimensional space. We can form a surface using this curve by rotating it about its axis of symmetry. Doing that, we see that we end up forming a sphere in three-dimensional space. Analogous to the definition of a circle, a sphere with center h, k, l, and radius r is defined to be the set of all points x, y, z such that the distance between x, y, z and center h, k, l is equal to the radius r. Mathematically, we can express this as follows. The distance between p and c can be found by using the distance formula for three-dimensional space. we substitute the expression for the distance of line segment PC with the following. The square root of the quantity x minus h squared plus the quantity y minus k squared plus the quantity z minus l squared equals r. We can make the equation more user-friendly by squaring both sides of the equation. Doing that, we obtain the final equation of a sphere with center hkl. The quantity x minus h squared plus the quantity y minus k squared plus the quantity z minus l squared equals r squared. Once again, notice how this equation is extremely similar to that of its two-dimensional counterpart. The only difference being that we included an extra variable. In this case, we included the variable z. Alright, in our next video, we will go over slightly more challenging examples that require the use of the distance formula.